All right, welcome. This is video four in our organic chemistry unit. This video is coupled with the next video, are both on functional groups. There are simply too many functional groups for me to go through in one video, so this is going to be the first of them. You will need your reference table for this, and you're going to need it open up to table R. Table R. Pirate's favorite reference table, table R. A functional group, you're going to need your notes open to page 14. So what is a functional group? This thing that we're going to spend actually 2 days on. A functional group, by definition, is a specific arrangement of atoms in an organic compound capable of producing reactions. For example, an alkene, a double bond, could actually be considered a functional group because it's a specific arrangement of atoms, meaning it's two carbons double bonded to one another. More typically, though, it involves oxygen. If you introduce oxygen into a carbon chain, into an organic compound, you get very different functionality. You get different reactivity. And that's why they're called functional groups, meaning a carbon chain that does not contain any oxygens will behave very differently than a carbon chain that does contain oxygens. And it matters how the oxygen is incorporated. Is the oxygen single bonded? Is it double bonded? Is there only one oxygen? Are there two oxygens? So they're called functional groups because they affect how the molecule functions. They affect how the molecule reacts. That's what we mean sort of by the functioning aspect. And table R on your reference table, if you notice, it's a really big table and it gives you a lot of information about these functional groups. So in these videos, I'm going to go through these functional groups, talk about how they're named. The first functional group, so in your notes, notice we have kind of the table that we're filling out. I will be abbreviating functional group as FG, just so you're aware. The first functional group we've actually already seen. So it's a halide or a halocarbon. So in that table, in that box that says functional group or halocarbon, you will want to write this down. So it's a chlorine, fluorine, bromine, or iodine that's bonded to a carbon, and that is what the functional group is, because that does change the reactivity of the carbon chain if it has a halogen bonded to it. The general formula, so that's the next box, would be this RCH2Cl. General formula meaning what is it going to look like? How is it going to appear? Now, an important thing for using table R is seeing this R show up, and you'll notice it's actually on the bottom of the page as well. There's a little asterisk, a little note at the bottom of table R that says R represents a bonded atom or group of atoms. What does that mean? It means essentially a carbon chain. So when I have an R here, for example, it could be one carbon, it could be two carbons, it could be 10 carbons. We don't really know how many carbons are bonded. The important thing is that we have this chlorine that's bonded to them. General properties of the halocarbons, they typically have higher boiling points. This is what you want to occur in that general properties one. Higher boiling points, the non-halocarbons. And if you've heard of chlorofluorocarbons or CFCs, which are responsible for ozone layer depletion, those are actually this category of compound. Going on, naming and drawing halocarbons. So we have a name it example and a draw it example, and you will want to write these down, these ones that I have up here on the slide. You will want to write them down in the name it and draw it slides. We've already named these, we've already drawn these, we've already seen these before. This is just a bit of a review. So if I want to name this compound on the left, I will start by finding the longest carbon chain, which is three. So that's prop. I will notice that the carbons are all single bonded, so I know it's ane. And then we name the substituent, which we've done before. So this is a halogen group, so this would be named bromo. So I'm going to stick a bromo in front of the propane. And then you number the carbon chain, so the substituent is on the smallest number of carbon, so one, two, three. I could also number it right to left. It would also be on the second carbon then. So the bromo is on the second carbon, so this is two bromopropane. And then if I'm drawing a halocarbon, again, we've done this before, but I'm going to start at the end, so it's pent, so I know I need to draw five carbons, one, two, three, four, five. And then I look at the suffix ane, that means that they're all single bonded, so I don't need to change how I've drawn them. And then iodo, what's that? That's an I, so I have to attach an I somewhere. Where am I going to attach that I? On the number one carbon, so on the very first carbon, I'm going to draw an I. Remember, halogens only make one bond, that's it, so I don't need to draw any extra bonds on that, but I do have to make sure that all of my carbons get a total of four bonds. Now, a new functional group, because we have seen halocarbons before. The next type is alcohol. So if you notice, right, we are going to be going right in order on table R, an alcohol. The functional group for an alcohol, you'll notice right here, is OH. Now, this is really, really important because this is actually not a base. Remember, a base needs a metal plus hydroxide equals base. But if we have a carbon plus this OH, which I'm not no longer going to call hydroxide, instead it's actually called hydroxyl, that means we have an alcohol. So this is not a base. This is a different type of compound. This is something called an alcohol. The general formula for an alcohol is this ROH. And again, R is just meaning any carbon chain. So if you have carbons that are attached to the OH group, now we're going to call that alcohol. And we see that functional group and that general formula also listed in table R. An example. So now we are going to be filling in the example with naming in that column. Where it says alcohol. We have an example, CH3OH. Now, this is an alcohol because it has a carbon that's bonded to an OH. Now, how do you name this? The name for alcohols end in OL. So we have this OL ending because of this OH. But then out in front, you have to say how many carbons are attached to that OH. So there's only one carbon. So the prefix for that is meth. And we actually keep most of the sort of the methane bit. So this would be called methanol, indicating one carbon bonded to an OH. Likewise, another example with naming C2H5OH. Well, the name ends in OL because of this OH that we have here. But now there are two carbons. So this is ethanol. Some properties of the of alcohols. They're found in mouthwash, they're found in cosmetics, they're soluble in water, and they're toxic. And you drink too much, or it's going to kill you. We're going to do the looks like column in class. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in class. I'm going to review these, so be prepared to fill in notes on that. A name it, draw it example with an alcohol. So if you look at the example that's in your reference table, you'll notice that there is a number. As soon as you have more than two carbons in your carbon chain, you will have to have a number in your alcohol to indicate where the OH is. So this example that's shown here for the name it, we want to name it. We know it's an alcohol because we have this OH group that's attached. There are three carbons in the chain. The prefix for that is prop. So this is going to be propanol. The OL ending because it's the alcohol. But then I have to say where, because as soon as we have more than two carbons, you have to say where the alcohol is. Which carbon is it on? So we're numbering our carbon chain, and it's on the OH is on the second carbon. So this would be 2-propanol. If we're drawing an alcohol going in the opposite direction, we have this example, 1-pentanol. The OL ending indicates alcohol. So I know I'm going to have an OH somewhere, but I want to start now with a pent. The pent is going to mean five carbons. So I'm going to draw five carbons, one, two, three, four, five. I know I have to have an OH attached, but I don't know where to put it. Oh, wait, yes, I do. It says 1-pentanol, so I'm going to put the OH on the number one carbon and then simply fill in and give every other carbon four bonds. You'll notice the example in your reference table is 1-propanol, which is different from this one here, 2-propanol. They've changed the location of where the OH is. Next functional group is the ether, and that is how that's pronounced, the ether. So the functional group, so again, you want to fill that in the same box that says ether, is C single bond O, single bond C. So again, we have one carbon. This is very similar to the alcohol. Again, the O is single bonded, but now instead of this being OH, now it's an oxygen that's actually incorporated into the carbon chain. The O is a part of the chain of carbons. The general formula for this is ROR. Remember, R meaning any number of chain of carbons. That's our general formula. The example with naming. So this is here is an example of an ether. Notice we have the carbon chain, we have C's, and then we have a single bond O, and then we have more C's. That's an ether. If I want to name this, the way we name an ether is that we split the chain in two where the oxygen is, and we name each portion as if it were a substituent. So, like it says right here, each R group is treated as an alkyl group, meaning as a substituent. So if I had this two carbon chain, that would be named ethyl, right? Two carbons. And then if I had this, which is also a two carbon chain, this would also be ethyl. And then you simply add the word ether. So this example right here would be ethyl ether. But if we have two of the same thing, we don't repeat it. Instead, we would say diethyl ether, and that's where it comes from. And the way to remember an ether, I love this saying, I'm going to say this a lot, there's a carbon on ether side of the oxygen, ha, 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 carbon on ether side of an O. But that's what an ether is. Property of ethers, they are anesthetics, so they will knock you out. That's what they do. You breathe a little bit of an ether in, and you will pass out pretty darn quickly. An example, some more examples of naming it and drawing it. So if we have this example here, which I can tell it's an ether because we have an oxygen and there's a carbon on ether side of the oxygen. Again, you split it in half at the O and you name each side as if it were a substituent. So this is four carbons, so this would be called butyl. This is one carbon, so this would be called methyl. You take those two together and then you simply add the word ether, because of that right there. So sort of putting it together, the name for this compound would be butyl methyl ether, right? Substituent, so treating as a substituent, and then the ether goes there. Now, I don't really, I'm not too fussed about the order, meaning if you said methyl butyl ether, I would not deduct for that. There is an order that you want to name them in, but it's sort of beyond what we're doing in here. And then dimethyl ether, well, the ether means that I have an oxygen in the middle of a carbon chain. This dimethyl out in front, that's really saying methyl, right, two methyl groups. It means that there's a methyl on one side and then a methyl on the other side. So if I have an O, I'm going to have a methyl group on one side, so one carbon on one side of the O, and then a methyl group on the other side. So this is one of the methyls, this is the other methyl, and then the fact that it's an ether, that's the oxygen. Now, a quick comment about carbon and oxygen and the number of bonds they make. Carbon, if you look at your periodic table, has four valence electrons. So if we drew the Lewis dot diagram, it would look like that, versus oxygen, which has six valence electrons. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Remember, it's the singleton, it's the lone electrons, the ones that aren't in a lone pair that actually participate in bonding. So carbon, because it has 1, 2, 3, 4 single electrons, it can form four bonds, and it does form four bonds. Versus oxygen, it only has 1, 2 single electrons, so it only forms two bonds. So you'll notice in the alcohol example, and now with the ether example, my oxygens here and here, right, they're only forming two bonds, so oxygen only gets two bonds. All right, next example of a functional group. Next functional group is the aldehyde. Aldehydes. Aldehyde, the functional group, which we're writing this in the same box that says aldehyde, is now a C double bond O that's next to a hydrogen. So now we still have oxygens, but now we're saying, hey, what happens if we double bond the oxygen rather than single bond it? If you look at your reference table, you'll see that C double bond O next to an H. The general formula is that R, you know, which could be sort of anything, next to a C with a C double bond O next to an H. This is critical. You need all of this to be a ketone. I'm sorry, to be an aldehyde. If that H isn't there, if it's a carbon instead, then it's actually not an aldehyde. The aldehyde needs a C double bond O next to an H. So that's an aldehyde. C double bond O next to an H. Example with naming. So we have this example here. This is our simplest possible aldehyde with just one carbon. So notice we have the C double bond O next to an H, and then if the thing that it's next to, if there's only one H, if there's only one carbon, then we would use our methane prefix, which we kind of use for functional groups. The ending for aldehydes actually ends in AL. So this would become methanal. So this is our aldehyde ending. Now, you have to be careful when you're pronouncing this. You need to summon all of your Western New York nasal accent and really call and really lay on that final A, methanal. This is methanal. Because if you say methanol, then it sounds like an alcohol. Alcohols end in OL, so you really have to make it like super nasally and say methanal. This is methanal. You'll notice there are actually no numbers. These other examples of namings up here, no numbers. Because your C double bond O has to be at the end of the carbon chain because it has to be next to a hydrogen. So we actually don't need to indicate where the C double bond O is in the chain because there's only one place for it to be. It has to be next to a hydrogen, and in order for it to be next to a hydrogen, it has to be at the end of the carbon chain. A property of aldehydes, they're fragrant. They are actually used as preservatives. If you've heard of formaldehyde, that is an aldehyde. It has that in the name. So an example, name it and draw it with an aldehyde. The example that's shown here on the right for name it, again, which you do want to copy down into your notes, this right here, right, that's the aldehyde portion. That's what makes it an aldehyde because I have a C double bond O next to an H. Remember, I know that this is an H because if it's just a dash with nothing written next to it, then it's an H. And if I want to name it, I want to count up how many carbons there are total. I do count that as the total for total number of carbons. So let's see, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 carbons total. 7 carbons. Prefix for 7 is hept, but it's functional group, so I'm going to add that kind of AN. And I know it's an aldehyde, so through the C double bond O next to an H, so I know the name is going to end in AL. So this is heptanal. Heptanal. If you look at the example that's in your reference table in the final column, you see you've got 3 carbons. So they used prop. So propanal, that's propanal in your reference table. If we want to draw an aldehyde for this example, butanal. Well, but, what does but mean? Hopefully by now you know that but means 4 carbons. So you want to draw a 4-carbon chain. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then that AL ending indicates the aldehyde. An aldehyde is a C that's double bonded to an O next to an H. So you want to use your last carbon in your chain to make the aldehyde. So I might take my last carbon, I put the C double, or your first, remember, because it's your first one is also your last one, depending on your direction. Make the last one C double bond O next to a hydrogen. And that's the aldehyde right there. And then simply go in and give all your other carbons 4 bonds. Make sure you only have a total of 4, right? Don't give it 5. It's but it says 4, so 4 carbons total. That includes the carbon that has the functional group. So that's aldehydes. And we're going to do one more on this particular video, and that is ketones, because ketones are highly related to aldehydes. The functional group of a ketone is a C double bond O. Now, notice that that is just like an aldehyde, but unlike an aldehyde, it has to be surrounded by carbons on all sides. So now it can't be next to a hydrogen. So now our general formula, we have to have this C double bond O, but it has to be surrounded by carbons. No hydrogens. And that's the distinction between the aldehyde and the ketone. The C double bond O is now coming in the middle of the carbon chain. An example with naming. So filling in that particular column, example with naming. This is the example of the aldehyde of the sorry of the ketone. So you want to sketch that in. Now, how do we name ketones? We keep our idea of our carbon prefixes, but now we're going to have this own ending, this O-N-E ending. And we have now be that the carbon double bond to an oxygen is actually somewhere in the middle of the carbon chain. Now you do have to use numbers to indicate where the C double bond O, which carb where the C double bond O is, which carbon in the chain has the double bonded oxygen. So this example right here is 2-pentanone. Pent because there's a total of 5 carbons, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons. Own because I have a C double bond O in that carbon chain, and I have to include the 2. This is 2-pentanone because the C double bond O is on the 1, 2 carbon in the chain, right? It's on the second carbon in the chain. Properties of ketones. Nail polish remover is acetone, which is a ketone. Acetone is the older name for a compound that's actually called now correctly called propanone. It's just that everyone's been calling it acetone for so long that we're not going to change, but its technical name is propanone. Nail polish remover, I mean, it's not exactly a property, but that's where we see a lot of, that's where we see ketones most frequently in everyday life. And just one final example for name it and draw it for ketones. So I know that this name it one is a ketone because I have this C double bond O that's in the middle of a chain. That's not at the end of the chain. If it was at the end of the chain, then it would be an aldehyde, but the C double bond O, it's in the middle of the chain, so I know it's a ketone. So if I want to name it, I want to start by figuring out how many carbons are in the chain total. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 carbons. So I'm going to use my 8 prefix, which is oct, but I'm going to add that an that we use for functional groups. This is what makes it a ketone. So the name is going to end in one. So I know this is going to be octanone. But I have to say which carbon has the double bonded oxygen on it. And if you're telling me that it's 5-octanone, my response is going to be there's no such thing as 5-octanone because, like everything else with organic, you need to number your carbon chain so that your substituent or whatever it is that you're looking at is closest to the number one carbon. So we are numbering this sucker left to right so that this, I'm sorry, right to left so that the C double bond O is on the fourth carbon. This is 4-octanone. There is no such thing as 5-octanone. It does not exist. It's just 4-octanone written in a slightly different way. Likewise to hexanone, hex is going to mean six carbons, right? Six carbons right here, and that O-N-E ending indicates that I'm going to have a C double bond O in my in the middle of my chain. That's my ketone ending. So I'm going to start by drawing six carbons, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and I know I have to put a double bond oxygen somewhere on one of those carbons. So which carbon am I going to put it on? I'm going to put it on the second carbon, and I'm actually going to go from the right this time just to mix it up a little bit. So that is the second carbon in the chain if I'm numbering it right to left, and that's it. That's my ketone. I just need to make sure that everything else, all the other carbons, have four bonds. So that's the first of our videos. The other video will cover acids and carboxylic acids and esters.